How you doing, everyone?
Let's get ready to rumble.
Yeah, let's do it. Catherine, Nicolas, Kyle, thank you for joining. It's exciting to talk virtually. It's been a while. I guess the starting point that I posed to Kyle was probably a little bit ambitious. I told him that he had to explain macroeconomics, QE, and modern monetary theory in 30 seconds to kick us off, just to set the stage, because we don't have a lot of time here. But while that is an exaggeration, I will lead with a prompt, and I want you to kind of agree or disagree with me. To me, there is only one thing that matters right now in crypto, and that is coronavirus case growth rate worldwide. Because as that goes, so goes world governments. As world governments go, so goes Bitcoin, and then everything trickles down from there. Are you seeing the same thing? Or am I just a crazy Bitcoin maximalist?
If you're asking me, we are seeing continued growth, especially since I guess we've been in quarantine for about 120 days now, which is almost our whole operations have been around about 9 months. So we've had a big chunk of time where we've been doing most of our growing during the lockdown. And we've seen a continued, pattern of growth, partially because we were new and now we're getting more established. But also, as you mentioned, there are just so many key components to which COVID is making crypto more relevant. You're stuck at home. So anything that you can do from your home, anything that you can do from your phone digitally, that's going to be access to different markets, and anything that you can do 24/7, because most folks maybe have to still work from home, but then they've got those off hours where they're not too sure what to do. So they're looking into markets, they're becoming, trying to follow something. Sports are closed. So we're seeing kind of all these events kind of domino effect into, as you said, farther crypto adoption, which is a positive, but also a negative in the fact that we're increasingly, lack of stability that exists in our own world.
Where am I wrong? Is it not just about Bitcoin?
I mean, it's definitely not just about Bitcoin. We've seen some serious growth here in alt season, picking up with the likes of folks really being able to have different markets that they can access, especially through Binance US. Some of our leading volumes the past few weeks have definitely not been Bitcoin, but certainly we saw around the halving that was led mostly or predominantly by Bitcoin flows. So I think as more people are becoming, aware of these different instruments that you can use inside of the digital asset space, they're getting more comfortable to test and try different things. We saw that with the Doge rally more recently, and then the Link and VeChain acceleration.
What do you think? Is this just picking up pennies in front of the steamroller? Or is there more to alt season this time around than just quick pumps and recycling? On mute, got him.
To answer your first question on COVID and crypto, long-term COVID is like the most bullish thing ever for crypto, both for digital gold, /Bitcoin, as well as for all the other trust-minimized applications. The thing that's the weirdest about this crisis is that people are realizing the news doesn't necessarily make sense anymore. Like a lot of things just don't add up correctly. And that's caused people to question broad-based institutions, which is scary actually in the near term and very, very good for crypto in the long term. I'm less convicted than you are that equities crashing by 30% tomorrow is necessarily bad for crypto. It's possible that correlation will tick up, but I'm not super convicted that that's the case. I'm very convicted though that this is all good for crypto in the long run, but that could be years. I'll defer to Catherine on comments on the duration of alt season. I think she has better insights into what's happening in alt season than I do.
Nicolas, how do you guys think about monitoring the impacts of everything that's going on a macro level with Ledger in particular? Because there are kind of new divisions of the business beyond just self-custody that have launched more recently. You could talk a little bit about those, and then what are some of the KPIs that you're looking at as you monitor just broad-based health and maybe, as Kyle put it, even catalysts for crypto more broadly?
Yeah, no, sure. I think first, I'd like to say I was quite surprised by the kind of volume that we got during lockdown, because we got maybe four times more sales. It's even more special for us because we are a hardware product. So actually, I mean, we had a very hard time shipping things and manufacturing things, but our team has been on top of that, which was great. I think that with more and more people learning to work remotely and learning about, well, all the constraints that you have related to that, people are probably going to look at crypto at one industry that solved already a lot of those problems. Because if you look at most crypto companies today, a lot of them can operate fully remotely. We had kind of an interesting board meeting, by the way, where people told us that, well, most of their portfolio were running around and trying to organize while we were overperforming, which was quite surprising. But I think that in the future, more and more people will look at the different issues that you have when you work remotely, and security and privacy is a very big issue regarding that. I mean, if you look at the news when lockdown started, you had a lot of discussion around Zoom and typically privacy in Zoom. I mean, people complained, they issued several patches. It's probably not fully encrypted end to end today. And well, we have a lot to bring in the protocols themselves. I mean, as an industry that already worked on all those constraints. And well, we brought some interesting solutions in privacy that maybe I can develop a little bit more later.
Maybe I'll open things up a little bit and we'll talk beyond just Bitcoin and coronavirus. I'm curious if some of the action that we've seen this year is more quote unquote fundamentals driven than in the past. Coley, you know, you see the ebbs and flows and kind of the ups and downs of speculative traders. But Nicolas, Kyle, you're kind of on different sides of the fundamentals question, right? For Nicolas, I'd imagine that people that are using Ledger Wallet are predominantly going to be making longer term investments. Kyle, you know, obviously, you know, by virtue of what you're doing, same thing. As you think about the fundamentals of assets beyond Bitcoin and kind of down the market cap pecking order, what do you think is closest to product market fit beyond just the digital gold use case right now? Ethereum had ICOs in 2017. Is DeFi as close as some people think it might be to product market fit, or is this still something that's in the test you know, net and sandbox right now? Go ahead, Kyle. We'll kick off with you and Nicolas can chime in.
So, you know, DeFi is kind of talk of the town these days. This growth and rate of innovation happening in DeFi today is impressive. I think if I were to summarize what is DeFi today in a couple of words, I would say it's trying to be decentralized Binance. Is basically what it is. I think that's a compliment, I think it's a very good thing. However, I think, like, if you look at Binance today, you know, a huge percentage of Binance's efforts are not just on facilitating trading existing coins, it's actually growing the kind of global ecosystem of people in crypto and onboarding net new people in the crypto. There's basically no evidence today support that DeFi is growing the market in any way, or is onboarding new users. And so as I look at, like, the market, I see, like, the funnel of, like, there's 7.5 billion people in the world. Like, some of them have heard of Bitcoin, some of them have bought Bitcoin, probably on Coinbase, Binance, or Hobi. Some of them have bought Ethereum, and, like, some of them have, like, withdrawn an ERC-20 and, like, started to do some DeFi things. And, like, that funnel is probably, like, a 99.9% drop off from top to bottom. And it's not clear that that part of the funnel is, like, reaching up and over the other parts to actually onboard new people. So for now, it's cool, but it's not really driving net new economic activity or behavior. It doesn't mean it can't. It's just not clear how you get from where we are right now with DeFi to there. So we like DeFi, it's cool. We're invested in some DeFi things. Where we're actually, if you want to talk about, like, real world impact of things happening, I think you're seeing a lot of interesting things happen kind of, like, on the margin that are less discussed. So, like, Helium today is in a very interesting position. LivePeer, Arweave, what are some of the other ones? Brave, you see all these, Reddit, like, you see all these companies that, like, they're either about to launch something really big, or they have a product now that is just, like, it's not in the gusto of the kind of day-to-day crypto community, but they're actually making meaningful real-world progress of doing things. And I'd say we probably more than most of our peers are really focused on trying to find those opportunities and make big bets on those.
Have any of those broadened the top of the funnel? or are the numbers still too small?
So like in many cases, those, so if you look at Helium as an example, you know, there's 4,500 hotspots in around the US today. I think they've already sold more than 10,000 that are sold out, that will ship by the end of the year. So 10,000 is not a large number of people, and some of those people have multiple. So the absolute number of hotspot owners is small, but that's actually irrelevant to the point. The point is now you've got hundreds of millions of people all over the world that are blanketed by this radio coverage that you only need 4,000 or 5,000 people to do to cover hundreds of millions. And so with that, you're going to start to see lots of companies say, wow, this is a new wireless network that never existed, and I can leverage that. And those companies don't know or care about crypto. And so you're going to, and live here is kind of a similar dynamic where you'll have a relatively small number of people, let's say measured in the hundreds or the thousands, who are operating the system. And then you'll have, you know, thousands or millions of users who are using it that don't even know what crypto is. And so we're starting to see those kinds of bespoke applications really grow in meaningful ways. And I expect that trend to accelerate meaningfully over the next 24 months.
Nicolas, is Kyle right? Is that the extent of the top of the funnel, Bitcoin, and then everything insular from Bitcoin and Ethereum on down? Or are you finding new users that are finding other avenues to Ledger as they fall down the crypto rabbit hole?
So we're seeing a very strong interest in buying Bitcoin, I think, mostly because, well, Bitcoin today in the media, if you talk about the crypto, people know about Bitcoin. I mean, even if you talk about Ethereum, people on the street, I mean, don't really know about it. So of course, in our community, I mean, it's well known, but when you buy a crypto, the first one you think about is Bitcoin. And what I noticed during lockdown is that, well, people try to buy Bitcoin on basically every app they could find. I mean, if you had an app that was an app to watch the price, for example, that had an option to buy Bitcoin, people would use that option just to buy Bitcoin, because I think with the lockdown, the crisis, I mean, people are just worried about the economic state, and so they are looking at different solutions. But regarding our users, they are not just using the product for Bitcoin. So we see a lot of interest in trying all kind of different protocols. So because I think that the thing is, when you have something, I mean, when you have a hardware wallet, you want to protect something that's going to be valuable. So if you start thinking at some point that your crypto is going to be valuable, I mean, in the future, or well, if you think that you own, or that you are going to be owning a little bit more later than what is the price of the hardware wallet, then you want to invest. That's my thesis, basically, to show the growth, because we have seen that, well, when prices are moving, I mean, users get interested. I mean, even if the prices are moving up or down. So that's really, I mean, that every time you have a trigger that make people think about, well, what the value of their assets could be, they think about a hardware wallet and they think about moving. So we are trying to, I mean, regarding the network effect, I think it's important as well, because once you have a lot of users playing with crypto, I mean, you can show them new services, and those services are, well, everything we do, I mean, every day in crypto, which is not very common in all kinds of applications, if we think about just owning your keys, I think today cryptocurrencies is the first application of cryptography that we put in everybody's hand with that kind of control. So if we can demonstrate that you can control your digital life with crypto, well, you might want to apply that to other solutions. And typically in COVID times, we are looking at solutions that get less and less, that put less and less control to users. For example, contact tracing applications. Well, if we had ways with crypto to solve the kind of problem that puts, and actually we have them, I mean, when we think about scalability, the knowledge proofs and so on, we might be able to change things for good, I think, from cryptocurrencies back to the real world.
Coley, I'll give the last question to you, and it kind of ties back to Bitcoin versus everything else. I know, you know, not every data company is as trustworthy with spot volumes data, but I know at Messari, when we look at it, Binance today, Bitcoin trading is about five times as much as the next several on any given day, with the exception of maybe, you know, intermittent spikes in volume with assets like LINK that have just gone crazy. So by and large, people are still getting in and out of stable coins and Bitcoin in and out. What are you doing at Binance to promote education around the non-Bitcoin use cases and some of these other assets that people might be able to use as they go down the virtual rabbit hole, not just the Bitcoin rabbit hole, as they're under lockdown, as you alluded to in your first response.
Yeah, one of the things we stand for that CZ put in place 3 years ago was the freedom of choice. So giving people the alternatives for them to decide their path into crypto and what suits them best. So we outline all of the coins that we list. We have over 70 trading pairs on Binance US. That's about 35 tokens available. And we have pages kind of discovering all about you or all about each token to walk people through how they can learn more about each thing. You can rely on the information from Messari. You can reach out to the Binance Research or Binance Academy to learn a little bit more about how you're going to be accessing these tools, the different trading ways, whether it's OTC, whether it's market orders, whether it's just our buy crypto button, and just continuing to educate people, not intimidate them in this space is what we really stand for. Because so much of it can seem confusing. Even a rabbit hole doesn't sound that inviting. So we are here to welcome more folks into the space and hopefully complete that funnel where you might see DeFi kind of narrowing it. We're here to continue to broaden the access to crypto for everyone.